Welcome, film fiends, to another episode of Video Ferox, where we're at the drive-in because we're watching a 1950s classic, depending on who you talk to, and its remake. We're watching The Blob with 100% less Steve McQueen. So settle back, grab your popcorn, and let's get gooey.
If it had a mind, you could reason with it. If it had a body, you could shoot it. If it had a heart, you could kill it. Now, man is no longer the supreme being on this planet.
The organism is growing at a geometric rate. By all accounts, it's at least 1,000 times its original mass.
Nobody believes me about what happened tonight.
What did happen?
You were there, you saw.
Plasmid life form that hunts its prey. Predator.
I want that organism alive.
I think you ticked it off.
No shape.
Alrighty, welcome back from the trailer to The Blob. Ian, did you like The Blob?
It has elements that are good, yes, but when I find myself easily distracted by when watching a movie and going, huh, I wonder what's happening on Facebook.
I'm the other end of the spectrum. I fucking dug the thing. I'm not saying that it doesn't have flaws, that it has issues. And, you know, the special effects haven't quite aged as well as some other special effects of the time. The compositing's a little hanky, but we'll get into all that. But generally, I think that it's a pretty solid movie. And if I were to compare the two, I'm going to take either the original 58 Blob or this one. I'm going to go this one 10 times out of 10.
I have no interest in ever watching it again.
Well, this is going to be an interesting episode, isn't it? So why don't we just get right to the spoilers, and shall we?
Yes.
Say it.
Because we're the same person.
So, if you hadn't gathered from the trailer, this is a remake of the 1958 Steve McQueen creature feature, The Blob. And it's more or less follows the same sort of story beats. It's a small town isolated from the rest of the world. It's up in the mountains. It's this little skiing village. And I love how the thing opens. I really dig that kind of sinister. It's, you know, empty streets and you hear the wind blowing and the there's crap blowing down the street.
Yeah.
Everything's empty. And you're thinking, okay, did the blob already rampage through here? What the hell's going on? And then it cuts to a cemetery, and you're thinking, okay, well, what the hell's going on here? The camera pans up and around, and, oh no, everybody's at the big game.
Yeah.
Because that's what you do in a small town.
Yeah, I think one of the things that I saw in the notes about the production is that the bulk of the shoot was at night, so the actors spent the bulk of their time sleeping during the day. And when they weren't working, they were eating crawfish. Apparently, they took advantage of Louisiana food and gorged themselves on it.
And so that's the first of the major subversions throughout this movie. Like, they kind of follow the Hitchcock trajectory where you meet good-looking hero whose name I suddenly can't remember. Taylor, I think his name was. And, is that right?
You're talking about the boyfriend?
Yeah, the school, the jock.
Paul.
And he's this all-American hero. I mean, he's kind of goofy for the girl, Meg. He is this, I mean, basically a jock. But he's not a jerk jock because his friend is the absolute jerk jock.
Can't remember the guy's name, but the guy who basically helmed getting this film into production admitted later that was his biggest mistake.
The movie was directed by Chuck Russell, who, if you're going to know anything, he did Nightmare on Elm Street 3.
Yeah.
And then the script was co-written by Frank Darabont, who you might have heard from one or two things like the fucking Shawshank Redemption.
He admits years later down the road, one of the biggest things that keeps the film from being really liked is the fact that he did a little too much comedy. And it's forced. It really comes across as forced when it's done. Almost to the point of like it's almost slapstick in places.
Whereas in I didn't particularly mind the comedy or, you know, the jokes didn't land with me and I didn't notice them. They didn't throw off my cadence. I thought the pacing and the jokes were fine.
I think a little bit of my point of view with this is flavored, poisoned, skewed by Carpenter and his work doing the thing. But when you look at it and you do the comparison, I like what Carpenter did. And when I'm sitting there watching the film, The Blob, I had the similar kind of expectation coming about because 1950s horror film in both instances, remake both 1980s, and I unfortunately let myself get, I'm expecting. Carpenter did what he did with The Thing, and I'm like, okay, are we going to get that here? Well, the special effects certainly are above and beyond what the original is.
Now, let's be absolutely fair. That's 30 years between the 50s Blob and the 80s Blob. So I'm not going to hold the original Blob's feet to the fire, if it had feet, because just technology moves on. Yeah. It was fine. If you take it on its own, it was perfectly fine.
Yeah. There's a bit of comedy that I feel is forced. There's an attempt at some comedy with the old guy out in the middle of nowhere with his dog, and it's a really great special effect with the object on fire, barreling down, going almost horizontally. So it does its crash landing, and he goes to investigate. And there's just a little bit of just comedy. And it's just like, we don't need comedy here. This is supposed to be suspense. So when the old guy pokes his stick into the goo and holds up this mass on the end of it, and then it falls down onto his hand, it's ruined for me because I'm like, there's no suspense here. I wanted some suspense.
When the movie lets fly with both barrels, and it gets to the body horror pretty quick because Paul, they position Paul as the lead, and then they promptly kill him in like 10 minutes into the movie. When they get around to killing him, that is fucking horrific, and just this gnarly, his face under the blob, and you can see him screaming and dissolving.
Yeah.
So, okay, gore does not necessarily instantly equate to suspense, so if, you know, I could see you might have a problem with that, but I thought that bit really fucking well done.
Yes, it's very well done. They told the gal playing Meg there wasn't going to be a real person underneath all of that.
Oh, yeah, it was just going to be a mannequin or something.
It's just so she goes to do, she gets into the scene and looks down and realizes that the actor is really underneath the goo. And when he starts moving, her reaction is genuine. She's like, holy, fuck.
So it's the bit from Alien. It's the chestburster scene from Alien where nobody knew except for like two crew.
Yeah. When it comes to this movie, a lot of the special effects are done really well. I have no problem with that. My problem is more to do with the presentation of the characters. Now, Paul is supposed to be interpreted as the hero. He's the guy we're watching, and the expectation buildup initially is this is the guy you're going to see through to the end of the film.
It's the Marion Crane of this movie.
Yes. This gets ruined for me is Kevin Dillon's character, Brian.
Who we haven't mentioned yet. The other third of the triumvirate of the opening characters is Brian. Brian Flagg, I think his name is.
Yeah.
And he is this typical bad boy. He drives a motorcycle. He wears a leather jacket. The cops are like, hey, you're turning 18 next month. We'll see you in jail, not juvie. You know, that sort of thing. He is clearly positioned as the bad guy of the piece.
Yeah. Well, here's where Paul being presented as the hero that you expect to see live through the film is quashed when Brian's character is getting more emphasis. He's getting more screen time. We're seeing more behind the scenes, unrelated to anything else going on in the film. So they're building a rapport between the audience and the character. They don't do that with Paul at all. I don't feel any rapport happening.
Whereas it worked for me because I instantly, knowing the tropes and knowing how these movies are supposed to play out, knowing that the Blob is supposed to be a love letter to creature features and the Blob specifically.
Yeah. My problem here, and I'd like to point out this is more for the audience than for Tony, is that I am a murder mystery suspense thriller buff. That's where my real love is. So I'm always looking for the hidden things. I can't help it. It's just intuitive.
Whereas in with the Blob, for me, I just got high as fuck and said, oh, look, big blink thing trying to eat the people. That's the extent of my analysis.
Yeah. In the 1958 version, it's Steve McQueen, and all of the attention in the whole thing is Steve McQueen. And it's not, this is early in his career. This is one of his first motion pictures that he's done.
Yeah, I think this was like his second or third, yeah. I think.
He's 28 years old, playing a high school student.
Okay, slight tangent for the original. That's the one thing that really bugs the fuck out of me is Steve McQueen is not a fucking teenager.
No. Now, one of the things with the original film and Steve McQueen and all of that is he's the strength character. All his performance, his screen presence, he's there. You are following what is happening. You know who the hero is.
Oh, I will absolutely give that Steve McQueen does a huge amount of lifting on that movie. He makes that entirely movie charming and fun.
Yeah. Turn it around, the 1988 version, it's the opposite. And not horribly in the regards to your leads are strong, they're not weak, but our director knows that the original had a problem with all of the supporting characters. So there's more there's more meat to it.
There's more color to everybody. Everybody is distinct. Everybody has like big glasses or like beards or a crazy old man that finds the Blob. There's the scientists. The only time you really kind of get generic people are the scientists, the people running around in the ABC suits.
Yeah. I really love the fact that you have this whole army unit turn up, and the guy in charge is a black man who isn't military, but he's in charge. And I'm like, kudos in regards to that. Because even in the 80s, heck, the 90s, we didn't see that.
I liked that all the military dudes were in fact not like dicks and not homogenous. The only real problem child of the scientist was the lead black dude. Like his right-hand man, the military guy who was actually military, the second he realized that the thing's getting out of control, all right, fuck this. We're going to blow it up and shoot it and kill this motherfucker because this is a bad, bad JoJo.
Yeah.
So I liked that they had personality. Again, back to everybody in town, everybody in this movie has color and personality and distinctiveness to them. Well, the one thing that they did with the characters that I really enjoyed was that they all had story arcs. They had some sort of, and not necessarily, and not super complex or deep, but they had a, you know, Flag, he starts off as the rough kid, the guy from the wrong side of the tracks, this loner, who then comes around to realizing that, okay, hey, I can save the town, so he comes around to being a good guy.
Yeah.
Meg, she starts out as this vapid cheerleader who then eventually, at the very end of the movie, steps up her game and is like going toe-to-toe with a fucking Blob.
Mm-hmm.
And I like, there's this one scene, Flag, he gets this snow-blowing truck thing to freeze the Blob because that's how you deal with these things. That gets wrecked. He gets sidelined somehow, and she comes running out and grabs this machine gun, this big old M16 or whatever it is. And it's a very small thing, but she goes to fire it. Oh, the safety's on, has to fumble for a second, gets it going, and then fires. And then, it shoots way the fuck up. Because if you've never touched a big machine gun like that before, I would never know how to fire this. Mm. I would be totally on her. I would be like, how'd the fucking thing work? Oh, there comes a blob. And I'd die.
Yeah, the term is muzzle climb.
And then she climbs up on top of the snowblower truck, which has crashed, and throws this satchel charge, which then she... There's this one bit when they throw the satchel charge down in the sewer to blow up the blob, and they purposely set up, hey, this is how you do it, and they have her in the background kind of observing it, very subtly.
Mm-hmm.
So they throw it in there, blows up, doesn't work. She grabs a satchel charge later in the movie, and it's like, okay, how does this work? Aha! Zip! And then... She's not a complete badass. She fucks up her dismount when she gets snagged and Flag has to come save her.
Yep.
So she's not an invincible superhero.
Yeah.
I really liked that.
There are things in the movie like that that are done really well. And there's where I see the strength of this film. Because all of the background, all of the supporting characters actually have chutzpah. You find yourself following what's happening. And there's... Because for me, when I sit to watch this film, it's like literally the first half of the film, I kept finding myself getting distracted. It wasn't until the military shows up and that I begin to actually earnestly pay attention to what's happening. Now, I want to go other background characters that I think really deserve an occasional nod to, because you don't see them frequently nowadays. Because, for example, there's the mechanic, the guy who runs the garage. Nobody's going to know the actor because this guy hardly ever appears in front of the camera, but everyone knows him. He's the guy who does the American dub in Cowboy Bebop.
Oh, he's Spike, right? I'm not Spike, he's Jet. He's fucking Jet.
Jet. Bo Billingsley. And so I always get this little... thrill when I see him in front of the camera, because it's just like, it's Jet.
Well, there's a bunch of actors in this like it, because, you know, the sheriff has a deputy. The deputy is fucking Emil from RoboCop.
Yeah, they called him Melty Man on the set because,
well, he's the fucking Melty Man. That's what I would call him if I met him. Being that this is a Frank Darabont movie, of course it's going to have Jeff DeMunn in it, and so he's the sheriff.
Yeah, there's a lot of really good background character actors that you see everywhere.
And of course we can't forget about fucking Bill Moseley in this, who's in there only for a couple of scenes. He's real brief.
Yeah. The guy from Power Rangers.
Oh, Lord Zed. I can't remember his name. Collingsworth. No, that's Black Shadows.
But Lord Zed is face. He's in this film.
Jack Nance is in a bunch of this. He's been from a bunch of David Lynch stuff.
Yeah.
So yeah, there's actually a pretty strong supporting cast throughout this thing.
Yeah.
The original Blob. I mean, okay, name one person out of that other than Steve McQueen.
So let's go a little bit into the special effects. Now, there's a couple of things that had me a little bit disappointed because. For example, at the very beginning, when they show the old guy poking the stick into the goo, you see the goo in the cavity of whatever it was that crash landed. But when he picks it up, it looks completely different.
That was the problem that if you go listen to the commentary, where they were saying it was really tough to take this shiny blob and match it to the color of the background and get the plates to look consistent. That was the biggest challenge, is getting the blob to look like the blob every shot.
That was one little disappointment. But there's other bits where, like, later in the hospital, they show the old man is alive and his eyes have turned completely white. It's like, the doctor comes up, peels the blanket away. He's in the lower half of him is gone. Well, while there is some compositing in the film, there's one where the entire sequence is in camera.
I'm going to guess it's probably the stunt on the bike.
Yep. That was some seriously good stunt coordinator putting it all together. because you have he demolishes the motorcycle. Both tires pop.
I think on the commentary they said that was basically being held up by like his two legs and that was it.
Yeah. Kudos to Kevin Dillon for doing the stunt, but just the whole rest of it, all the other little elements are all cued, choreographed. It's all in camera. There's no monkeying with it. And that's where I'm like, okay.
I also love how they set up the stunt, because this whole movie is full of Chekhov's guns, where they have, here's the thing, and here's the payoff. They had the very first time we meet Flag, and he is making a run for the bridge, and his bike starts stalling out, and he wipes out and dumps into off the end of the bridge.
Yeah.
And it's like, God damn it, and that's where Crazy Ralph up on the other side of the hill says, I'm going to take your beer can, off he goes to find the blob.
Yeah.
So, and then, of course, when it matters, when it's really important, and he's got to make that jump because he's being chased by the fucking army, off he goes. So I love touches like that all throughout the movie.
It's like the one army guy. The one that is in real life, is a Vietnam vet. He, due to serving in Vietnam and whatnot, both legs have been amputated and one of his arms.
And then when Meg finds this soldier, half-digested soldier, rolls him over, and, like, he's still alive and still struggling.
Yeah.
Because he has no arms and legs.
Yeah. It's a shame that things happen to people, but the fact that...
Make lemonade out of your lemons.
Exactly. And it's like... And he's all like, help me! And his arm's gone, and he's just... Blah.
Okay, it's been a while since we've done this. What was your favorite kill?
My favorite kill? Erica Eleniak makes one of her cameo appearances, Playboy Playmate from the 80s. She's a high school cheerleader or whatever, and they're out in the car.
His jerk friend has him out on Lover's Lane, basically.
Yeah, she's passed out. Passed out. And he's like, oh, Larry, let me make you a bit more comfortable. Undoes one button. He's totally unaware of the fact that the blob has taken up residence.
That's another thing that I love about the movie, is that the blob is actually, like, intelligent and, like, hunts. Because yeah. Here he is infecting this woman, inside this woman, and just lying there dormant until creepy stalker rapist dude's like, oh, let's have a little sexy time. And then the blob says, fuck you, and jumps him. Why did it wait that whole 5 minutes? Because he's a dick.
Yeah.
The blob, not the guy. Well, yeah. The guy's a dick too.
My initial reaction to this bit at the beginning of this segment is a continuity error, because in any previous instance where the blob has done anything, the blob hasn't done that. It isn't until in retrospect you begin to realize, oh.
It's kind of clever.
This freaking creature has a brain. There's an intelligence. That's my favorite kill.
I'm going to have to go with the phone booth. And not so much that it's a really visceral kill. I mean, here's the poor waitress diner owner. She's trapped in the phone booth and the blob's enveloping and all that. That's pretty fucking nasty and it's pretty gnarly. And she's trying to hold the blob out and it's oozing under the door. That's pretty good. But the scene where the sheriff just kind of drifts by in this enzyme soup and stares her in the face and, like, she goes, ah! That 1-2 punch fucking does it for me.
See, I almost thought you were going to go with the sink.
The sink was number two. The sink was a very close number two.
Now, I have to admit that would be my next go-to for favorite, because it's just like, he reaches into the sink. He's like, oh, what is this shit?
And the thing is, you're kind of expecting it to, like, oh, he's reaching in there, something's going to happen. No, he just comes out with some goo on his hand. It's nothing. It's not until the blob comes out to get him and then pulls him to the ass down. That it happens. So, yeah, that's definitely number two on my list.
Yeah. There's an attempt for setting it up for a sequel. And I think it's done really well. Now, earlier in the film, we see the preacher, he gets hurt.
By, like, a flamethrower more than the blob. So yeah. That's how he survives.
Yeah. He initially comes across as just a little bit flaky as a priest. No, now he's disturbed. Because he's talking about the post-apocalyptic. Blah.
And to be fair, he has post-apocalyptics in his little jar on his desk. He could cause the second coming at any time.
Yeah. What? How does he say it?
the sign will be coming soon or something like
yeah.
that.
Yeah. As soon as God tells me, I'm opening this jar. Fuck. And I'm disappointed that with how badly this film did.
Because it had a budget of, well, depending on the source you talk to, because Darabont and the director say, no, it wasn't nearly that much. But the studio says it was like $18 million. And the thing, it made like $9 million. So it absolutely face-planted.
Yeah. It would have been neat to have seen a sequel. And to see that actor come back, I think he's since passed away. But to see that actor come back and his delusional, and like, ha ha ha, open the jar.
Can I nitpick for just 1 second?
Nitpick?
Yeah. So this sleepy little town up in the mountains that has maybe a population of maybe 5,000 tops. Why the fuck does it need sewers that wide that you can drive a goddamn semi through?
Major metropolis, and we don't have sewers that big.
I kept watching this saying, what the fuck? How much poop do you guys generate? This is insane.
Yeah. I think at that point I had already just said, all right, whatever. They're going to do whatever.
So at the end of the day, would you recommend The Blob, the new Blob?
Yes. I feel a lot of people in regards to the nostalgia of seeing a film that's a remake of a predecessor, they'll enjoy this one. I'm sadly poisoned with expectations that I can't always turn off. Anyway.
All right. I think we're done. Yes. I think we're done. We're done.
We're done.
We're done. Alrighty, thank you for joining us as we got into The Blob. That sounded better into my head. Next week, Therese and I, we're going to be taking a look at the criminally underrated Joe Dante classic, Matinee. So come back here for that. Until then, please drop us an email, thevideonastyproject@gmail.com. And I want you to stay squishy and evil. Squishy evil.
Beware of the blob, it creeps and leaps and glides and slides across the floor, right through the door and all around.